My 8th video provides a general overview of numerous phenomena in relation to the wave particle duality. It describes in physical terms electromagnetic waves, photons and particles, and several physical processes in the classical and quantum mechanics. This high-level overview assumes and requires that you have already sufficient knowledge of the many different topics. For more easy reading, see my Excel file video frames on my website. The wave-particle duality goes primarily about photons and electrons. Sometimes they behave like waves and in other circumstances like particles. In fact, it is very simple. Even after 300 years of research, we still don't really understand the wave-particle duality and there is still no universal theory. In this video I will try to shed some light on the different interpretations. With waves we mean electromagnetic waves. A photon is often seen like a wave package of pure energy. Personally, I interpret it also like a droplet of energy. My further interpretation is that a photon rides an electromagnetic wave at a certain frequency. An electron I still interpret like in the classical mechanics. Due to a charge, a movement induces a magnetic field, which can make an electron also behave like a wave. The behavior depends on the actual situation and the relative electromagnetic fields and forces involved. The debate goes back more than 300 years to Christian Huygens and Newton. We have learned the breaking of light according to the law of Snellius, and that light is a form of electromagnetic waves, which all have the wave velocity equal to the speed of light. With a dual slit we have learned the interference pattern, with lines described by linear paths of hyperboles. The relation of Planck describes the energy of photons. With the photoelectric effect, light freed electrons out of different materials. The atom model of Bohr and the spectral lines required discrete packages of energy. Dr. Quantum illustrated that even individual photons and electrons behave like waves. But with the presence of an observer, the interference pattern disappears. Within the quantum mechanics, the basic formula drops simply out of the sky. And with no more than some practical assumption, we build a completely new theory, without really understanding its basis and correct interpretation. Lack of real understanding is often camouflaged by a lot of math. And even after 100 years, there is still no correct and easy to understand physical explanation. Therefore, I will do my best to provide my own. Please note that in English, P is M times V is called momentum. And a change in momentum is called an impulse. In Dutch, P is called an impulse. And there is no separate word for the change in this impulse. With the substitution of P as MV, the formula for the kinetic energy takes different forms. E equals PC follows out of Einstein's relativity theory. Herein is P the momentum of a photon without the mass. All the often used derivations based on E is MC squared are fundamentally wrong. In E is PC stands P for the momentum of a photon. In my opinion, the formula and physical processes are more based on the scalar values than on the direction of the momentum vectors. What I mean by this is that the receiver may simply experience a massless photon like a package of free-to-use potential energy, with no prescribed direction in which it is effective and must be used. Thus for the receiver only the amount of energy of a photon may be relevant and no longer its original direction. Without this assumption, the interaction processes between a photon and moving particle would be far more complicated and difficult to explain. Often it is said that a wave is a particle or that a particle is a wave. For a proper understanding, it's much better to maintain a clear distinction. Particles and wave go often hand in hand, but they are two different physical entities that involve different physical processes. Philosophically, they form a unity of opposites like yin and yang that makes everything flow. Maxwell worked on electrical systems with magnetic and capacitive components, which resulted ultimately in two different sets of equations. He concluded that also light is an electromagnetic wave. Now we know that the electromagnetic waves have the speed of light and that there is a direct relation with the magnetic permeability and the electric permittivity. The interaction with an electromagnetic wave can to some extent be illustrated with the use of a so-called LC resonator. The resonance oscillation is a function of time. However, when used as a radio transmitter, the induced electromagnetic wave is a function of length with the same frequency. This is directly comparable with the excitation of a rope. With electromagnetic waves, the magnetic excitation becomes helical left or right, like will be illustrated next. With the LC resonator, the apparent current moves back and forth between the two physical components. An electromagnetic wave utilizes an infinite series of virtual electrical components in empty space, and moves on to the next virtual component that is always already there. Light and photons can then be interpreted like a virtually fully rectified sinusoidal current. Based on the formulas for an LC resonator and light, I have made some bold practical assumptions. Then it appears that the pitch of the virtual helix is constant, and the wavelength and cross-sectional area of the components are linear proportional to the number of windings. The product of the photon energy and the cross-section is then constant. The photon energy relates then to the cross-sectional area of the virtual components, which depends on the frequency. In fact, the propagation is longitudinal and not transversal, like often illustrated. This unique interpretation provides an easy-to-understand visual picture of the functioning of an electromagnetic wave. Hopefully, it provides also some food for thought. We all feel daily the energy from the sun, which is the source of all life in our solar system. Photons generated in the sun take 150,000 years to escape and reach the Earth in 8 minutes. Personally, I interpret the photon like a package of radiation energy that rides an electromagnetic wave with almost the same frequency. The photon energy comes free at the end of the wave. Who or what will receive the photon energy depends on the direction of the wave and the specific circumstances. The receiver is free to use this energy to his liking, like with photosynthesis. The original direction of the wave seems then no longer really important. This is comparable with the energy transfer in waves at sea. What happens at the end of the wave depends more on the local circumstances at the impact site than on the original direction of the incoming wave. Since photons have no mass, this is even more so with photon energy. To some extent, it is also comparable with raindrops. The direction, size and frequency of the raindrops do all matter. But as soon as the rain hits, the only thing that really counts is that you get wet. Often a photon is described like a wave package made up out of the superposition of, for example, 20 waves, with amplitudes that are normally distributed. The frequency within such a package is not completely constant. Then the frequency can only be almost the same as that of the EM wave it rides. With the speed of light, the electromagnetic wave itself is possibly always slightly ahead of the photon. This is like you can hear a car coming. Maybe the speed of a photon is even infinitely slightly less than the speed of light for the electromagnetic wave it rides. Light travels in a straight line and normally you don't see the beam of light. You can only see the reflection of light that hits your eyes directly. However, the beam of a laser pen can easily be made visible with some dust of a whiteboard or some water vapor. Part of a photon energy is then already reflected before the beam hits its final destination. Fast movements create the illusion of figures on the wall due to the energy absorption and reflection processes on the wall and our slow observation. Lasers with different energy levels have all sorts of medical and technical applications. In the classical mechanics, we learned that electrons are particles and have a well-defined mass and electrical charge. This was demonstrated by Crookes and Thomson. Its motion and charge may cause magnetic self-induction and make the electron behave like a wave. But this does not make an electron a wave. Originally, the quantum mechanics are fully based on the classical mechanics for a particle. The classical formula for the kinetic energy applies to a particle with a mass. We all know that the kinetic energy is independent from the direction of the movement of the mass. The Schrödinger wave equation is based on the classical Hamiltonian for a mass particle. The only difference is that now an electromagnetic force field is assumed. Also, the hypothesis of the de Broglie is fundamentally for a mass particle. The several practical assumptions that are made miss in fact a solid scientific foundation and have only proven to be very useful. For educational purposes and a proper physical understanding, a more clear distinction should be made between the original basis and the later, more general interpretations. My personal interpretations are intended to contribute to a more easy to understand physical explanation. The atom model of Niels Bohr assumes the excitation and fallback of electrons, like in an infinite well. Then photons must be seen like discrete packages of energy. An important question is why and how photon energy is transferred into kinetic energy of the electron, and vice versa. What is precisely the role of the direction of the impulse of a photon? For easy explanation, I interpret a photon just like a package potential energy that can be observed by the electron and transferred into kinetic energy. This also involves an increase in the strength of the magnetic field. Thereby the direction of the photon seems to play no role. A reduction in kinetic energy and magnetic field releases a photon with the same or a different frequency. The diagram illustrates the excitation of an electron by a photon. The new velocity depends heavily on the initial energy and thus initial velocity of the electron. With low frequencies the photon has hardly any effect. With very high frequency the velocity would approach or even become greater than the velocity of light. We all know that this is not possible and thus the theory and formula can then no longer apply. In total that leaves only a very small range of frequencies where the excitation and fallback can occur. The excitation and fallback can be demonstrated on the basis of the familiar diagram with the energy levels of a hydrogen atom. This diagram has been adapted to also show the velocity of the electron as function of the frequency. The quantum states and energy levels are listed at the right side. With a quantum state 2 or higher, the energy levels are in the range of 10 to 14 electrovolt, and then the velocity of the electron is almost constant at about 2 million meters per second. A nearly constant velocity and energy level means that with higher frequencies, the width of the well must increase with almost the same ratio. This within each of the series and also between the series. To me, the relation between the familiar diagram and the quantum well remains still somewhat unclear. The photoelectric effect can in fact be explained on the basis of analog frequencies of light. Thereby the photons would not have to be discrete packages of energy. However, if you assume a combination with the atom model of Bohr, discrete packages are required. The photoelectric effect can also be considered in relation to my earlier explanation of tunneling. An electron needs to have sufficient kinetic energy and a suitable trajectory to be able to escape through an atom opening. The lines for different materials may then also depend on different combinations of the strength of the atom force field and the spacing of the atoms. The dual slit experiments demonstrate that continuous light and also individual fired photons create a well-known interference pattern that can be described by the classical wave theory. Usual explanations are that an individual photon interferes with itself, or that it follows all possible paths at the same time. For educational purposes, a much easier interpretation is that the interference pattern is created by the magnetic wave that the photon rides. The photon follows then the antinodes or crest of the superposition of the magnetic field, where the magnetic field is the strongest. This field may already be created by the slightly earlier arrival of the electromagnetic wave that the photon rides. This must not be seen like a pilot wave, but as the result of how a photon seems to ride an electromagnetic wave. With an observer, the interferential pattern disappears. My simplistic explanation is that the observer is surrounded by its own relatively strong force fields, and that these disturb the much weaker magnetic interferential field, such that it completely collapses, which then makes the photon behave like a particle. Such a disturbance by a relatively large object is similar to when moving close to the aerial of a classical radio or television. Also, a single electron creates an interferential pattern. My personal explanation is that the charge of the moving electron induces a magnetic field, which results in an interferential pattern similar to that with photons. My Excel file, Light Magic, provides additional figures and a further explanation. The excellent animation by Dr. Quantum illustrates the intriguing behavior of single-fired photons with a dual slit. The photon goes through one slit, the other, both, or neither. Unfortunately, Dr. Quantum does not provide an explanation. My own simplistic interpretation is that the energy of a photon can be seen like silly putty. It can act like solid, a jelly, fluid, divide, rejoin, and takes all sorts of shapes. Something already occurs with the electromagnetic wave in front of the slits. Behind the slits, the energy rides one or more of the antinodes, where the magnetic field is the strongest. It may not be scientifically correct, but it certainly paints the picture. I presume that an electron can only go through one slit at a time, and cannot divide and go through two slits at the same time. With all this knowledge, we now must readdress the question why light goes through transparent materials and neutrinos through everything. My simple answer is that to photons and neutrinos the atom frame appears largely empty. Since a photon has no mass and no charge, the force field around the atoms have no effect, so that the photon sees relatively large atom openings. The breaking of light may be even caused by the interference of the atoms on the electromagnetic wave moving through. Maybe the breaking of light is then even comparable to that with a gravity lens. A neutrino has little mass but no electric charge, and thus no magnetic field. It moves through atoms like a rocket through empty space. Collisions are few, like with the gold foil experiment and colliding galaxies. This figure illustrates the four fundamental forces and some major historical scientific developments. The left upper half covers the classical mechanics like gravity, electricity, atom physics and radioactivity. The right lower half covers the field of quantum mechanics and subatomic particle theory. Often a combination of both halves is needed to explain the overall physics and beyond. Quantum mechanics claims that it can provide a more fundamental explanation for the phenomena in the classical mechanics. This may be so, but then they still have to do quite a bit of work. Then they also have to develop and provide a fully understandable physical explanation. The wave-particle duality remains weird because we still not fully comprehend it. In my opinion, it's in fact only a question of different scale and electromagnetic forces that play a more prominent role. Photons are energy and photosynthesis created life. The different types of forces and energy make everything interact and flow, all in their own peculiar way. We know a lot, but there is certainly still a lot to be discovered and explained. Also with this video, my primary goal was to develop an easy to understand physical explanation of quantum mechanics, suitable for teachers and students at Dutch high schools and beyond. A secondary goal was to develop also a critical scientific attitude. My personal interpretations and explanations are to a large extent in compliance with the basics and fundamentals of the quantum mechanics. But at times I have taken the liberty to provide my own more easy to understand interpretation and explanation. Hereby I invite the experts in the field and other educators to develop and provide an entirely correct and easier to understand explanation. Please visit my website for the file video frames and lots of additional information. I certainly would welcome your constructive comments on this video.